Hello, Facebook Live. We are Sovereign Nation Wrestling, and we have just wrapped up our first debut show, Pride and Glory of 2023. And we are here with the new British Heavyweight Champion, the Cult of Killjoy, the hometown hero of York. Here he is, Killjoy!
Killjoy, we trust. It is a pleasure to see you. Thank you so much for having me on. Thank you.
Thanks for coming.
How does it feel to be the first British Heavyweight Championship champion of Sovereign Nation Wrestling?
I mean, being a belt feels great. It feels amazing. Like, I never really thought I'd be able to hold like a championship, let alone a heavyweight championship. I used to always play with like the model replicas as a kid, so the fact that I was able to win it not only tonight, not only be the first champion of Sovereign Nation Wrestling, but also in my hometown, it's honestly it's such a special moment for me. And it feels absolutely unbelievable.
Now in the pre-show, we was debating whether or not Tommy Rocco was going to turn up. Throughout the whole afternoon, and it's been a long day, around the whole afternoon, and he didn't show up, so you came out to the challenge, and then Tommy Rocca got involved. Now, what do you have to do to mentally prepare to go into a triple threat match? Because not only are you facing one person, but you're also facing another person, and they're coming out all directions. What mentally prepares you for that?
Mentally, it's a struggle. Triple threat matches are not like any other matches. Even just tonight, Tommy Rocca, strong, powerful. He could break a brick in half just like with one finger. Dan, he's quick. He's an amazing striker. He's one of the... In fact, I am of the opinion Dan Devane is what is the future of British professional wrestling, as well as me. But being a triple threat is not... It's unlike anything you ever have to do. It's, like you said, people come from every direction. You have to keep on your toes. You have to keep aware and just keep... You just have to keep looking and figure out, what's my opening? Can I get in here? Pin, cover, break that up. You need to adapt yourself and be the best version of yourself if you have any hope of winning a triple threat or even surviving a triple threat.
Speaking of surviving, you pulled out some killer moves in that ring. Now I know why Killjoy is the name. And that must be brutal on your body. How do you recover after a match like that?
Well, I'm going to have a nice lovely bath, put on face mask, get cucumbers in my eyes. Honestly, both of them hit hard. Tommy suplexes. I felt like my spine was going to go at any moment. I felt like...
Thank you very much, my friend.
We're saying bye to Sheep McToon. Take care, we're on Facebook Live.
Yeah, see you guys later on. Thank you.
Dan Devane as well. Bruised me with strikes. Lit me up with kicks. It's hard. Like, it will be a long road to recovery, but this is what I do. This is why we do what we do. Because yes, the pain, but also the pain makes us better. Because without pain, there is no pride and glory.
Yes. Now, quick question before we get to the final question. What was the inspiration for you to get into wrestling? This is one question we always ask our guests, isn't it? What got you and inspired you into wrestling?
Honestly, my dad. My dad used to watch wrestling when he was when I was very, very young. And
He's still very young.
He didn't know I did this. Anytime he'd be watching it, our stairs would lead out, there'd be a wall, and then you come up the stairs and you're in the living room. I would always peek behind the wall on the stairs and watch it with him without him knowing, because at the time I was too young to watch it, because this was around the Ruthless Aggression era. So we had Benoit, Angle, Cena when he was Dr. Tokenomics. It was around that time, and I just would always just be fascinated by it.
Who influenced by WWE, also WWF? Who was the one wrestler that stabbed you the most that inspired you to create this character?
Honestly, people like rest in peace, Bray Wyatt, the cult gimmick, I've always wanted to do. I've always been inspired by guys like Eddie Guerrero, obviously, for example, I know it's unpopular, but Chris Benoit has been an inspiration for me as well. Like, those guys, because I grew up watching them, I've always known them, and I've always gone back and watched old tapes, because the history of professional wrestling is something I very much treasure, and I think it's something that more modern wrestlers should also treasure as well.
We've heard that a lot where a lot of wrestlers have... We're just going to say bye to Nisa. Bye, Nisa.
Bye, Nisa.
We've heard from a lot of wrestlers how British wrestling is, you know, the institute of our wrestling style, you know, and we've adapted more to the American or like the kind of Lucha Libre style. So I think it's really good that there are wrestlers that support British wrestling and want to keep that, you know, history going. And one of my final questions, I don't think it's that many questions, but one of my final questions is, now that you are the British Heavyweight Champion, you have now got a massive target right there on your shoulders.
I know.
Who is going to be your dream opponent to face for that championship? Everyone's going to be after you right now.
Everyone will be coming after me. I did see the Battle Royal. I know Reese and Lightning, they did win that Battle Royal. So if boys, if once you start your differences, you're more than welcome to come for a shot. Johnny Storm as well, he's on my list. I appreciate the fact Johnny Storm saved me tonight, but I also know Johnny Storm has a taste for gold, and if he wants to have a crack at me, I'm more than willing to beat up, defend the championship against Johnny Storm. Yeah.
Amazing. So, any questions?
I thought, can you show off the belt to
Yes.
Your set audience?
Yeah.
Like goals.
The British Heavyweight Championship of Sovereign Nation Wrestling.
Even better in person. Okay,
it's the shine on this.
The
incredible.
final question from you, Killjoy. If you had anything to say to the people that have supported you or anyone that's wanting to get into this business, what advice would you give them?
Yeah. Thank you. For those who want to get into this business, I never thought I would. I always thought I'd be the 7-year-old kid who would keep watching like old WWF tapes and practice in his room on his teddy bear. It's possible, okay? I'm only 20 years old and I've already done so much. It is possible. You need to go out there and find who you are first. Like, you cannot be a copy of someone else. You cannot be a copy of a wrestler you've seen and just copy everything they do. You need to be you, your own original being. Because this may seem impossible, and it wasn't possible for me until tonight. And if it's possible for me to be sat here holding this, then it's possible for absolutely anyone. Just keep going. And hey, if you need help, the Comic Killjoy is always there. Just let me know. In Killjoy, we trust.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Champion. Thank you.
Thank you. Our British Heavyweight Champion, everybody. Wow, that was very inspiring. The bell is beautiful. I don't even think pictures do it justice. Like, honestly, it's amazing. Bye, Tiger. Wrestling legend Tiger over there. Tommy Rocker. Finally turned up. The lady killer.
I'm going
careful. What is it?
Maybe.
Hi guys.
Hello. We have Monty here with us.
First show in the bag.
It was amazing. How do you feel after that? The adrenaline must just be like wild right now.
Yeah, I feel great at the moment. I'm going to be exhausted tomorrow morning, I'm sure. But everybody was where they needed to be, except for that Tommy Rocker.
Yes. Not Tommy Rocker.
Yes. Tommy, when he rocks up.
I mean, he's like, you know, a punk rocker. He can do what he wants. He's just got that laid-back style about him, you know. The lady killer. That's his new thing. Okay, so just quick question. What was the reasoning behind creating Sovereign Nation Wrestling? Like, what inspired you to create this?
So, I've always been involved in wrestling since 2011 in various different ways. And I've always tried to be an active competitor, never actually made it for whatever reason. And this opportunity basically fell in my lap about 3 months ago to join up with the guys that were planning this, and I was like, yeah, definitely. So it's been a lot of sleepless nights, a lot of late nights and hard work, but to see that first show go and for all the performers to be as on board as they were, you know, it didn't go without a hitch. You know, we had teething problems, everything does, but for it to go how it did, it was amazing.
That's
we just got to build on it now.
That's, oh, They're taking down the ring, everybody. That's the beauty of the behind the scenes. So, obviously, you know, you've created Sovereign Nation Wrestling. Where do you see the future of this company? What is your kind of goal? Obviously, you announced tonight that we have a show countdown in January, yep. January 28th, I believe.
Right here,
Melody Park. What is like your what should people expect for the next show? What's your baby steps?
So obviously, countdown is in January. I'm quite happy to announce on Facebook Live that that's going to involve, let's say, a gauntlet style match, which is on the American style of the Royal Rumble, where we're going to have 20 competitors.
Wow, 20.
Going in and over to
we might need bigger ring.
But in that, not everybody's going to be in together. They're going to start with two in the ring. After 2 minutes, somebody else will come out and eliminate that's going to be in January. We've got some exciting stuff coming in the new year. We've got plans in place for a show called Extreme Nation, which is where every match is going to be a gimmick match. You might have some standing, you might have hardcore matches, all that sort of thing.
TLC,
yeah.
Steel Cage.
Oh, that's ambitious.
That is ambitious.
I need a bigger venue for Steel Cage.
Yeah, we'll do a Hell in a Cell next time.
For the second show.
Baby steps. So eventually what we want to do is we want to have a weekly show on YouTube showcasing the matches that have been on that month. Every month and see where it goes from there. What we want to do by this time next year, obviously we're taking December off. We don't want to compete with Christmas. We want to have a charity show. And we will basically, nobody will earn out of it. It will be all the proceeds will go to charity. So that's what we're looking at for next December. So there's a lot of exciting things going on.
Amazing, that sounds incredible. So what was your standout match for the night?
For me, it's I would say one of the best ones was the triple threat. Between the triple threat at the end and the tag team match, because they were both great matches. Because I was backstage, I didn't actually catch what went on at the end of the Battle Royal. All I saw when I looked out was Reese Lightning standing over his tag team partner. I mean, if somebody's in, I'm going to have to go back and watch the footage.
Well, but just to recap, what had happened was, unfortunately, Big Bad Duncan's partner was eliminated and he decided to eliminate himself. And I think he did that in a tactical way because he knew that Thunder and Lightning would have to go face to face. And that must have like a big impact on their relationship in January. You know, to face your partner that you've been a tag team with for all this time, that's going to be pretty hard and there's going to be a lot of like wounds and tears.
That's going to be interesting. It's going to be brutal. It's going to be interesting. I mean, obviously nobody saw that coming, those two, I'm going to put them in.
No, I don't think anybody saw that coming. I don't think anybody saw Big Duncan eliminating him.
No, to be quite honest, Big Duncan must have been one of the favourites going into that match. It's very exciting what's going on. What I do want to just acknowledge before I disappear is my partner, Karen.
Who's been an incredible, she's done amazing for, you know, taking pictures throughout the night, and she's got some awesome shots.
And the support that she's given me in the build-up to this has been amazing. Karen's not had any interest or involvement in wrestling whatsoever, and she's had a bit of a trash talk. She's had to learn on the job, but I think you're getting it, aren't
you? I think you should give a pat on your back. I think you should give a clap to Karen.
And I will give you your due as well. At the beginning of the Battle Royal, I saw Dan Domain almost came straight over on top of you.
Happened a few times. Nearly got squashed.
Dangers of the job. But thank you guys that were here. If you're now watching on Facebook Live, thank you for anybody that has joined us on Facebook Live. If you watch the pre-show and this media conference, join us in person in January. Look out on social media for all our posts. We'll be promoting the hell out of it as we have done this show, and we'll see you in January.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much. Can I have a question? You can be released. You can
I'll pass you on to our GM.
General manager. Oh no, this room really has jobs.
Good evening, General Manager Gareth Goldthorpe, everybody.
Welcome.
So, Gareth, how did you feel today has gone?
Like Chris said, didn't go without a hitch. It was tricky, but this show's been an absolute joy to be a part of. The group of wrestlers that we've got together, the staff, everything from the staff, we've got everyone together. It's been a really good camaraderie, so I was fairly confident that we were going to do well. I didn't think we'd do as well as we have done today. Everything has gone really well, apart from the early doors, the issues with Tommy Lester. But, like I say, it never goes without a hitch. But, no, I'm proud of everybody.
I think we can let that go. I mean, I've seen Tommy, you know. We can let that go. Okay, so Gareth,
until
next time. So, obviously, you was announced as the General Manager after the Battle Royale. What can we expect for you in terms of this company and what you're going to bring in terms of your management skills? Like, how involved are you going to be with Sovereign Nation Wrestling?
Hopefully I won't need to be as involved on like enjoying the shows as what I was tonight at the start. I want to make sure that I put the best matches together, listen to the fans. That's the most important thing. I listen to the wrestlers as well. They're the experts, they know what works, what doesn't. But yes, my involvement hopefully will be more of a backstory.
I want to congratulate you again for the incredible show. It was so smooth and so fresh.
Thank you very much.
Definitely a great first impression for a new company.
Oh, I really appreciate that. Thank you very much.
So I've got a question. Obviously, you are the General Manager, and that is going to, you know, you are going to be in charge of the wrestlers, I'm assuming.
Yes.
You're going to be in charge of the wrestlers. What kind of vision do you see for the roster? Like, what kind of wrestlers do you expect to join the company? Because we have had some incredible wrestlers tonight, from the likes of, you know, our champion Killjoy, and then, you know, who knows who will be the future champion in Countdown in January? Is it going to be Nick Thunder? Is it going to be Reese Lightning? We just don't know. And what kind of wrestlers do you want to gather?
I would like the wrestlers that are willing to put themselves out of the comfort zone. I'm already getting a lot of videos, and Chris has had them sent as well. I'm looking for wrestlers that are willing to put themselves out of the comfort zone. I don't want to come and copy what they're doing elsewhere. I want Sovereign Nation Wrestling to be different. So if they're willing to come out of the comfort zone, then the chances are they'll definitely get an opportunity.
Final question, what was your favourite match of the evening? Because there's many.
Yeah, it has to be the triple threat. I would like to, you know, make a special mention for the tag match. It was fantastic, but there wasn't a match on that show where the fans weren't engaged, and they were all absolutely fantastic.
It was a really good crowd. Like, they were very involved and very interested. Excuse the noise. We have a comment. Vendetta was brutal. Yes, they were indeed.
They were brutal.
Okay, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
We have heard from our General Manager. Thank you so much.
No,
we
hope
you have a nice evening, and we can't wait for future events with Sovereign Nation.
And thank you very much for the fantastic job you guys have done. You've been absolutely brilliant.
So. I know. You know
we do. Thank you very much.
We'll see if they say that in January.
General Manager.
Okay, now, ladies and gentlemen, introducing the Northern Division champion. Still, it is Callum Majakester. I mean, he's been covered.
Yeah, well. I say I'll move it out of the way.
That is one beauty of a title. How does it feel walking out still champion?
I mean, as you can imagine, it feels great. You know,
I worked a long time to become a champion. For those that don't know, I started wrestling when I was 11 years old. I'm now 22. I've not long celebrated my 11 year anniversary in wrestling, so I actually won that belt on my 11 year anniversary, so that was something special. I think to face someone like Brooklyn, who is essentially a guy that I did kind of grow up with, you know, we went to college together, we've known each other for many years. He definitely, obviously, I know he took some time out because he was injured. He did better than obviously I anticipated. I certainly wasn't ready for the reaction I got from the crowd. As you know, I'm not very well liked at most places.
Yeah,
I don't get why people don't like me. And then, yeah, as soon as I stepped through those doors and just hearing the shit, that was just, it completely threw me off. But obviously, I'm still a champion, and obviously, Brooklyn did what he did. But I think something I do want to say is, I know it's a show in January. If Brooklyn's available, then I'm willing to offer him a rematch. I feel like, you know, I don't know, maybe there's just something there, but I feel like me and Brooklyn, there's just something between us. And if I don't say this now, he'll probably go on social media and he'll cry about it. So I may as well offer him out now. Brooklyn, I will offer you a rematch January 28th, is it?
January 28th.
I will offer a rematch for the Northern Division Championship.
Speaking of, obviously, you know, you've got history with Brooklyn Connors. We saw your, you know, promo on Sovereign Nation Wrestling, and you did proclaim that, you know, Brooklyn was like a thorn in your side.
Yeah.
And how you made him. How do you feel coming out of that match after that? Do you have a different perspective going face to face with Brooklyn?
I feel like I've got a different perspective. I do certainly feel like there's still something in my side about him. I feel like I say, when I'm off the rematch, I feel like me and him just aren't done yet. I feel like we've probably got more to do together. So, yeah, there's still that bit in my side, but I feel like come next time, whatever the stipulation, whatever happens, we leave that in the ring. That's it, me and him stuck. If he wants to shake hands in the ring and end it at that, that's fine. If he doesn't, I'm sure he's a bigger man here. So, whatever happens.
What would you say? Because obviously with wrestling, you know, it takes a massive toll on your body, and yeah, you know, they do say that, you know, the longer you are in this business, you know, the harder it's going to be as you get older. What kind of things do you do to kind of, you know, help these, you know, yourself after a match?
After a match, well, it used to be, before I started a diet, I used to just have a cold one when I got home, but I'm on a diet now, like I say, so I can't really do anything, but I reckon tonight it'll be a nice little muscle sort of back. It's whatever my mum buys from the supermarket, at least. Whatever it's called, I don't know. So it'll probably would have left.
You want to make the biggest bubble bath.
Just give me all the bubbles. I made my pyro in the bath.
So, Callum McJakester, obviously, is your wrestling persona.
Yes.
How did you come up with that? Because we heard from, you know, Killjoy to be your own person when it comes to wrestling, and not try and, you know, be a wish gimmick, should we say, of another wrestler. What kind of makes you who you are?
So, I think my thing is, again, you know, it's a tenure I've had in wrestling. Yeah. I'm 11 years old, and I spent so long trying to find me. You know, I mean, when I first died, I was literally, I kid you not, a little kid dressed up as Jeff Hardy. I had the full get up and everything, the face paint. I think Caleb Crowe was in that match, and he looked at me and he was like, I'm so glad no one's going to call me Jeff Hardy now, because Jeff Hardy.
And obviously Caleb Crowe is now the incredible succubus.
Absolutely, yes, succubus.
Yes.
I didn't even realise that, you know, but yeah, that's... yeah, that's mad. And again, I spent a lot of time kind of feeling angry. That's kind of where the upgrade came from, was the anger, and like, I'm going to outshine everyone. But now it's sort of mellowing out a bit. I'm starting to kind of realise and understand this is wrestling, this is what happens. But if you don't like me, if you love me, then great. I'm either going to get one reaction or the other. And it's more just trying not to let that get to my core, you know what I mean? Trying to stay too much. Kind of how that all came about.
I mean, I must admit, like, I've had the, obviously, pleasure of actually being in the ring with you training for, we did one session, and we got to practice a couple of things. For someone that is an aspiring, you know, wrestler who wants to get into the business, what advice would you give them, and, you know, what should they take away from your experiences?
I think train as hard as you can. That's the one thing I would say. Train. So the one thing I try to do on people's mind is just go to training session. We're at a lucky time in wrestling now where there's so many accessible wrestling schools. It is unbelievable. Like when I first started, you didn't have this many wrestling schools. So the fact that there is this many now is absolutely mental. And another thing is, take constructive criticism. Don't take being berated. Okay, if you think someone is bullying you or anything like that, ignore it. Listen to the people that are watching your matches, watching your training, giving you advice, not putting it down. Because that is something I did deal with at the beginning of my training.
I think that's the thing with, like, you know, training is some people take constructive criticism, you know, quite hard.
Yes.
And it's actually designed to make you a better wrestler. Like, I remember we practiced a move, and it was like something that I'd seen, and I really wanted to practice it, but in reality, kind of, it didn't really work because it needed to be more fast paced. And when I got feedback from a certain wrestler, I'm not going to say names, but they're awesome. You know, their constructive criticism did help me develop that move and actually do something a little bit different. So, yeah. Well, I want to say a massive thank you for this little interview. Hopefully, we get some more. And again, congratulations, still the Northern Division champion.
Before you go from Shorty Bell?
Of course, yes.
No, go to us to them. They can't see you. Go close.
There we go. Nice beauty. Thank you. Callum McJake.
Thank you very much, guys.
Take care. I got in there first. Maybe this will be the match. This will be the January match.
Can I come back, please? Oh. GM Garrow's
we
back.
Have the GM wanting to come back.
Hello, how are you? See, I'm not hogging the limelight, but I have just got off the phone to a certain wonder kid, Johnny Storm, who was here as a guest this afternoon, ended up wrestling in a fantastic match against Matty Mayhem. He was victorious. I can now announce that we have managed to sign Johnny Storm. Sorry, <there. laughs> Johnny Storm on a multi-show deal. He will now be returning on numerous occasions in the year 2024.
Wow!
And in addition to that, in January he will go one-on-one with Tommy Rocker as part of Countdown.
Wow, well, you heard it here first, folks. Tommy Rocker versus Johnny Storm. We had the pleasure of speaking to him earlier this
week. We did.
Yeah.
We need to get Tommy Rocker on here, I think.
We need to get Tommy Rocker on here,
definitely. We need to get his opinions.
Have we got any more guests?
Actually, I've got a bunch
of people. Oh, the Future Proof Princess is here. Right, let me tell you all something. First of all, you wanted to start off by cheering me.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, Callum McJakes comes out with a shiny belt. And you're all, oh, Callum. Guess what? It should have been me that you were cheering. You all turned your back on me. Every single one of you. You saw it. You were stood there. As soon as Callum walked out with this title that he doesn't even deserve. You all loved him? Where was the love for me? And do you know what? Even better, Callum said that the next show, in January, he wants to put his title on the line again. I don't just want, like, a normal match. Callum, let's up the ante, baby. If you want a tables match, bring it. If you want a falls count anywhere match, bring it.
If you want a no-holds-barred match, bring it. I am the future of this company. Because I am future-proof. And everyone knows it. You know it?
You know it.
And I know it. So let me tell you something. Come January, the Northern Division is about to get that little bit more fabulous.
Toodles. Slay! Well, you heard it here first. The future-proof princess, Brooklyn Connors, is going to go face-to-face with Callum Jackson. They have accepted their challenge in January. January 28th. At Countdown. I always think of Carol Baldwin when I say Countdown.
Yes, I do.
Countdown. Can I have a bow, please?
Hey!
Oh, I don't know. Well, I guess the future-proof princess does need their crown to become a queen. So will they be crowned the Northern Division champion at Countdown in January? Who knows? Well, I think that wraps it up.
I'm sipping more gas.
My brain is frazzled. So you've heard it here first. We're going to see Johnny Storm come back. We are going to see Tommy Rocco go face to face with him, and Callum Majakester versus the future-proof princess Brooklyn Connors, and many more matches. So I am excited to see what happens. Thank you so much, Facebook, and everybody out there for watching. I am your host, Drew Ashlin, aka maybe someone else in January.
And I am your I'll say music man. I'm a music man, Callum, playing the tunes. And you'll see me in January, I'm here.
Yes, we will be back. Not sure in what capacity, but we will be back.
You can find us, if you look hard enough.
You can find us on Suffering Nation Wrestling on Facebook, X, formerly known as Twitter, and many more social medias. Just keep your eyes out. We will be posting promos, videos. Hopefully we will be up on YouTube, like we heard from, you know, the owner of this company. He wants to have a weekly show, so we will be back. But yes, thank you so much. Have a good night. Safe journey home,
thank
even
you
though you're
all
not driving on Facebook, and we will see you soon. Mwah. Mwah. So, can
see
you
later.
End the live? Because I will give everybody a show. You have to end it on the corner.
Oh, there. I'm not very tech savvy, I'm a DJ.